Okay, well, as you know, today's main topic is multi-scale modeling. We've certainly alluded to it over the course of the last few days, and now we're going to talk about it a bit more specifically. So our first speaker today is Madhav Bharate. He's a professor of computer science here at Virginia Tech, and he's the director of the Network Dynamics and Simulation Science Laboratory, NDSSL. That's one of those abbreviations you may have heard. He got his Bachelor of Technology degree in Computer Science and Engineering from the Indian Institute of Technology in Madras, and his PhD in Computer Science from the University of Albany, which is part of the State University of New York system. Before he came to Virginia Tech, which was in 2005, he worked in the Basic and Applied Simulation Science Group at Los Alamos National Laboratories. He was team leader there in a theory-based advanced simulation program, and they were representing, designing, and analyzing extremely large socio-technical and critical infrastructure systems. So you can see how people come in with a variety of different backgrounds and can apply that in a lot of different ways, and obviously today he's going to be talking about things that are related to systems biology. He's received a number of distinctions. He was recipient of a Distinguished Copyright Award for TransSim Software, which is an achievement award at Los Alamos National Lab, and he was recipient of the University of Albany Distinguished Alumni Award. So the title of his presentation today is Multiscale Modeling and Systems Biology.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dave, and good morning to you all. The good thing about Dave's introduction was that he clearly said, I'm not a demonologist. But luckily for me, Kate was somewhere there, one of our students, was gone on to take a successful career. She spoke yesterday, and Joseph is here. So when you ask me hard questions on immunology, I take that you all are experts in that field, and I will let them, you know, give answers. For the mathematical side, luckily Stephen is here too. So most of the time, I'll do the talking, but the questions will be, you know, crowdsourced out. I have 45 minutes, and I'm filling up for Dr. Martin, I believe, who was supposed to be here giving the talk. So pardon if you see, you know, not very well prepared slides. I've tried to do my best, and I would like to acknowledge Maksudul Alam, who is a graduate student in our group, and who helped me put together this talk in a short time. So what I thought I should cover, and we can of course do this somewhat informally, as I understand also, is to try and tell you what I think multi-scale modeling means. Given that you folks are immunologists, I can try and give you a perspective that is slightly different from a mathematical and computer science standpoint. Trying to dig up papers and looking at things, I tried to even understand what scale means, and I found out that the definition of scale is not that straightforward. So even the word is not that clear. So I'll try to use some basic version of the definition. And then touch upon why such modeling methods are important, why should one consider it, what issues arise, what are the pitfalls, and at least put out a slide on which summarizes some of the efforts on this topic in the broader area of systems biology. And then we will try and give a couple of examples. One is about a problem that appears in putting stents in heart, and I've taken this example from somebody else's presentation, in fact, Google's talk, and then I will talk about NEC, and I think Stephen already spoke about NEC, and there's also another practicum on NEC too, so I'll use that as an example and outline the NEC work. So we have 45 minutes, and we'll hopefully be able to at least touch on these issues, certainly not all the details. I would like to acknowledge given this is a lecture, I've tried to use material from many, many different sources. These are some of the papers and websites I've picked up stuff. There are lots of nice pictures on the web, and I wanted to acknowledge where I got them from. They're certainly not all made by us. And I will try to make sure that the acknowledgments are where the pictures come in too, but I didn't have the time to do that. But these are the papers that I have certainly referred to while putting together this talk. So let's start. what do I mean by multi-scale modeling in general? At least this is a working definition we'll use. Multi-scale modeling refers to a style of modeling in which multiple models at different scales are used simultaneously to describe a system, right? And all these words will become clearer. The key is that these models, at least the way this definition is used, the models at different scales have to be fairly explicit. You know, in some ways, we always use implicit models at different scales in building out single-scale models too. And this whole idea of multi-scale model, of course, originated back in physical world where people were studying fluid dynamics of various kinds. But in systems biology, this is actually something that is taken off in a big way. So in some ways, what I say is that scale here defines the granularity, and in some ways, the units in which you measure certain aspects of time, spatial, functional domain, right? And in our setting, we will move from time, which goes from, you know, in systems biology in general, we move from time, which is from minus 10 to the minus 6 seconds, to all the way to 10 to the 9 seconds, assuming you lived in 80 years, and you can calculate that stuff with the number you get. And from a scale of space, you move from space which is in nanometers all the way to, you know, if you study social systems where disease is spread, talk about meters and thousands of meters and kilometers. And finally, you have a very clean, at least at this level of a talk, a hierarchy, a functional hierarchy, or a scale in biological systems, starting from atoms to molecules to cells to tissues to organs to organ systems to organisms to societies and environment, right? So this is a setting that is by and large well established in biology, and we'll use these scales to discuss the work in this lecture here. So the key idea then in the context of systems biology is that you want to build a model, you know, a multi-scale modeling framework, a model for every scale. And as I said, scale could represent a functional scale, or a temporal scale, or a spatial scale, or they could all be combined, and you'll see that happening. But we'll try to enforce the fact that each scale, the model is somewhat explicit in its form, which means that you know, it's not implicitly picked up by some parameters, right? And I think that this basic idea has become so interesting and important in biological systems world that there is a consortium now called the Multiscale Modeling Consortium, and they have a nice wiki called IMAC. It's a part of Interagency Modeling Group. Grace Peng at NBIB leads it, but it tells you that this particular topical area is something that is very active at least at NIH and CDC. Right? So here's a figure that I picked up from Martin's paper, and I thought since I was almost certain he would have shown you this picture if he had given you the talk. But I think this picture really captures the basic sense of the things that we are going to talk about today. So we have on one side various sense of scales in terms of time, or this is actually space. There is scales in terms of functional groups, and associated with it, what the figure tries and shows you is that you have different experimental approaches to measure something about the system. So biologists have spent a lot of time coming up with very innovative techniques to measure aspects at different scales. And these measurements play an important role when you actually build these models out, right? Oftentimes, without these measurements, the models might not make as much sense. And on the left are various modeling approaches, and I will talk about them a little bit as I go along. And Joseph, if you think that some of it is repetition and you should skip over, I'm happy to do that. Since I didn't attend the previous talks, there might indeed be the case. So what I've tried to do is, I've tried to at least organize, given that it's a lecture and you want to at least have some sense of takeaway messages, a way to characterize these models in the biosystem world. So people use these terms variously in various forms, and at least I would like to mention them, because if you have heard them, then you can go back and take a look at them. So One is top-down versus bottom-up model, right? You must have all heard of it. Effectively, the word actually captures what it means. Top-down means that you have phenomena that you observe and you try and build a model at a lower level that tries and explains the phenomena that you observe at a certain level. The bottom-up is a way where you try and construct a set of models from smaller parts and try to have the phenomena that you observed at the top sort of emerge out of these interactions or models at the bottom level. And you can have multiple scales again in that particular setting. People have used continuous versus discrete models, and we talked about a particular class of discrete models that we see in the setting. But effectively, continuous models really came through in the world of physics originally and biochemistry, where you were studying fluids of one kind or other, right? On the other hand, discrete models are models in which space and time are discrete. There are examples that people have, of examples of such models include the Boolean networks. They're also, I believe, called Kaufman networks. Just general network science itself, discrete dynamical systems, graphical dynamical systems, they all capture this aspect of discrete techniques. And then you have models which are on one hand statistical or capture phenomena, and on the other hand are mechanistic and causal. There's a nice paper by Craver, I believe, which I think makes a very good point and highlights the fact that just because you have a mechanistic model doesn't mean it's a model that explains why things happen in a particular way. And I would highly recommend that you read that paper, and I will be happy to give you that reference. I think it makes a very good point. But you want to remember these sort of three attributes to classify models as you go along. Any questions so far? So, one of the questions, and I try to give a brief answer, is why do you want to even consider multi-scale model, right? You know, we're all fairly comfortable in single-scale models. So first is that, and these are the reasons I have come up with, you know, at least what I think. And the reasons, there might be others, and I'd be happy to listen to them from you all. One reason I think multi-scale models are useful are they really fit naturally with the scales that are inherent in biological systems, right? So if you want to study cells and intercellular interactions, then you would think that you have a model of how the cell works, of a particular, at least part of the cell that you care about, and then you have a model which talks about interaction between these cells. And this distinction is well captured in a multi-scale model. So that's one reason you want to consider this. The second is that oftentimes the information that you're seeking when you build a higher scale, you know, macro scale model as they call, is simply not available if you do not represent the micro scale in some reasonable and effective way. And we'll talk about some examples if we get a chance. But this is something that is important in this particular setting that we would like to capture. The other reason to do this, of course, is sometimes, depending on how you do these models, you can really improve the computational cost of running these models, of building these models out. You can, of course, build one large, gigantic model, but if you do that, oftentimes you lose the ability to do any meaningful computation. So multi-scale models sometimes help you to abstract out what happens at a lower scale and use that abstracted information up in the higher scales to improve the computational speed. Done wrongly, of course, this actually, you know, increases the time it takes to compute this. Finally, the way people expertise in scientists is such that oftentimes some folks would know one part of the system very well, and this, much like VLSI designs in computer science, where you know you build a large scale design, or you know organizational designs where you want to study parts of the system and then use what people are now well aware of called APIs, or you know, programming interfaces. So you can actually build a model at a particular scale, and then only interact with that set of folks through this well-established set of rules, move information back and forth, right? It makes for overcoming the cognitive limitation. One has to understand the entire scale in an effective manner. And this way of decomposing and modularity might seem naive, but if you start building very, very large models of entire organs or the entire human systems, then it's really impossible to have the breadth of knowledge to be able to capture this in a meaningful way. So that's actually an important reason, in my opinion, why such models have been done. So I've talked a little bit about this. When should I consider multi-scale modeling in biological biosystems? So again, I've tried to come up with some answers for this. One is when representations at the micro scale are important to drive the representation at a higher scale, then you really want to have these two scales represented explicitly. Otherwise, oftentimes you might not be able to observe a certain phenomena at a higher scale because of the implicit representation you've had. It might be the case, as we discussed before, the computational resources that are available are such that if we again do this wrong, then you might not be able to study the phenomena at hand, and then you might want to use multi-scale models available. So this is a picture I picked up from a paper by Walpole and Pierce, and it tells you how, when you build these multi-scale models, strategies to combine these models together. So on one hand, building these multi-scale models is fairly easy, right? You might say, okay, I have a model of a cell. When I try to build a model of interaction between cells, I'll just use model for each cell and then combine them. But turns out this way of composing these models in a meaningful way is actually non-trivial and is at the heart of the scientific research in this area. So at least to tell you different ways people combine this, one is in a very direct way where you use information from the first scale and pass it as a piece of information to the second scale, this API-like form that I talked about, right? But there's no feedback that goes on into this. You take the information from the second scale and pass it down as information to the third scale, and so on and so forth. There is another form, which is a completely parallel running of these simulations or models, which share information. The form that is used most, I would say, in research literature, is one which looks something like this, where you're running the simulation at one of the scales, typically micro scale. You know, you collect some information, pass that information to the simulation at the higher scale, take that information, run this simulation itself, pass the information back to the simulation at the micro scale, and so on and so forth. So this, I'll use the word docking somewhat informally, but the way to dock these models effectively is basically the research question at hand that you have in studying these things. This one tries to show it the same thing, but it says that you have different models at different time points. That's the only difference that this is captured. So what are the pitfalls? We alluded to some of them. One is that meaningful explicit models at relevant scales might not exist, so that you know, even if you want to design such a multi-scale system, you might just not have the right model set for every scale. One of the big pitfalls is what sort of information is exchanged and how are these models docked together, the previous picture I showed. This becomes a problem, especially when you start calibrating and validating the system. It's not so hard to build a model. What is hard is to make a model that somebody has some trust in it, or somebody believes and replicates certain phenomena at hand in a meaningful manner. That's the hard part, in my opinion. Building a model is not that hard. And the last part that people should be aware of in these things is computational complexity. In some ways, building a computational model is not very hard. You can quickly make something, right? The hard thing comes because, first, as the system becomes complicated, the program you write becomes that much more complicated. So, you know, it just becomes harder, and that's one measure of computational complexity. The program becomes complicated dealing with. The other aspect of complexity that comes about, even if you're a good programmer, is that the way you have written your models is such that the resources it takes to run it on a computer keeps growing. And fundamentally, this is a big problem that we all face. We think that we have supercomputers, we should be able to solve the basic problems at hand. As you know, right now there are machines with more than 300,000 cores. In fact, now there are machines with close to 1 million cores on it. And you might think that should be plenty in terms of doing a reasonably large simulation. It turns out, and I'll give you some number which I borrowed from Stephen's slide, so you will see them again. Even a small simulation, if you really want to study it exhaustively, is so big that you really cannot enumerate or understand the system completely. And there might be questions where you might seek such an answer. I'm not, there are certainly times when you want to understand the entire possibilities that the system can produce. So what is hard or tricky or where the science comes in or where even art comes in is to build models that are on one hand tractable computationally. And by tractability, I mean both understandability, three parts, understandability, ability to write the program in a meaningful way, quickly enough, because if it takes you 10 years to do this, I do not call it tractable, even if it runs very fast. And we did face issues like that in some of the work we did in epidemiology before, where by the time the questions we were asked were coded down into an algorithm, when we were studying H1N1, and Stephen was leading that project, the problem essentially went away. We were trying to support a policy question about the H1N1 pandemic, and we thought it was a very simple problem. We tried to code it in the simulation we had, but by the time we finished, by and large, the problem had subsided. So as Stephen puts it, we were really always solving yesterday's problem today. So we want to sort of leapfrog it forward in this sense. And finally, the running time on the machine. So the second part is, in computer science, called human productivity. That's the term they use, but it's a part of computational complexity, all right. And finally, other pitfall is data. Now, some of the papers have said that if you do not have data, then it makes no sense to build these models. I do not agree with it. I think sometimes you build models to come up with a plausible explanation of the phenomena, and over time, methods do get developed that allow you to measure certain aspects of it, right? So I think a good example for me is Higgs boson that everybody has heard about now. You know, this, at least theoretically, was predicted long time back. Our measurement systems were simply not sophisticated enough up until last year to try and even say that such a element exists, right? But nevertheless, the theoretical framework allowed you to direct the experimental search, right? So I do not think that you should stop building models just because you do not have the data, but you should understand then what the use of that model is and what calibration and validation would mean in such a setting. And I'm sure people have talked about this before. But I would like to raise this, and then we can talk about it in the roundtable discussion too. So here's a slide that I've copied it from a paper that Pedro Mendes and his colleague wrote. And again, it's in the references, which I'll be happy to share. It gives you a survey of different kinds of applications of multi-scale modeling in the world right now. The ones that they highlight are the ones that are programs that are well underway and produce interesting insights from a biological standpoint. One program that I know is the Human Physiome Project. I took a picture from that. It's a program that has been ongoing for a good 10 to 12 years now, if not more, led by Hunter and his colleagues, which tries to understand the physiology and understand the human systems in terms of all the different organ systems that it's made of. And so a team is leading in understanding of the heart, which itself is a multi-scale model. A team is leading understanding of the kidney. Another team is leading understanding of the lungs, and so on and so forth. So this is a simple example to start off on the sort of high-level discussion we had. And I took this example from one of the slide decks I found on the web. And I'll quickly go through it because I think it explains it in a different setting. It's the instant restenosis of the heart. It's about putting a stent in a heart and figuring out whether that will help or not. As the author points out, that we're talking about multiple scales here. The physical scale of an artery is about 10 to the minus 3 meters. Red blood cells, 10 to the minus 6 meters. And the question they are going to study is, when we have a coronary artery disease and you place stent, you get buildup of new cells in this area where the initial problem was, and the goal is to prevent such a phenomena from occurring in patients. So people have built out models in various fields. I know one group which is done. Subra Suresh, who used to be at NSF and was the director of NSF, and now president at CMU, has actually a long-standing interest in this particular topic. where you use fluid dynamical models at multiple scales to study questions of this sort. They basically would build multiple models related to, you know, platelet aggregation, blood flows, drug diffusion, cell cycle and cell signaling, and then try and come up with some kind of prediction where placing the stent would affect, you know, adversely affect the artery or not, right? And the figure captures the basic structure here. It tells you the temporal scale on one side and the physical scale, and tells you where each of the models lies in this setting. So the other example I will talk about, which you have heard now, is probably three or four times, and the purpose of this whole summer program here is about mucosal gut immunity. This is actually a work, and I would like to tell you the story, because Kate is here, and we find it quite fascinating. Me and Stephen are not immunologists by training. In fact, we are far away as an immunologist. Joseph is an immunologist. And Kate was a graduate student in our group and was a really adventurous graduate student. And she, when she was taking the courses here, she heard the work that was ongoing in immunology in Joseph's lab and other labs at BBI. And when she started talking to us and heard about the work we were doing in epidemiology and building very detailed models about how people move from one location to another, and we use such a model to understand how diseases transmit at the scale of a city, she really asked this question: why can't we use that modeling framework to study how cells move from on a tissue site and study the phenotypic changes in these cells? And all of us felt this was a crazy idea to begin with, but seemed to at least make sense in theory. But it turns out it was really a good idea, and she finished her PhD thesis and has gone on to do very well. You heard her yesterday. And in fact, it led to a collaboration with Joseph and led to this whole program from our side. So students many times drive interesting research problems, in my opinion. And I'm hoping one of you will listen to this lecture and come with another crazy idea to take forward and lead to some interesting science. But that's the genesis of this work that I'm going to describe to you here. And as I said, the modeling framework that we use is really a framework that we developed in the context of epidemiology, and I don't know if Stephen told you about it or not. Our group has a long-standing interest in developing computational models of how diseases spread in urban regions. And we use what's called an agent-based model, and Stephen, I'm sure, told you about it, and we'll talk about it again. And we use the same basic structure here as well, because conceptually, for us mathematicians, a cell was no different from a human being. A location, the building location was no different from a tissue site. It's just that the mathematical functions and the states that these things were carrying in the program were somewhat different. But conceptually, they were all very, very similar. We also have an interesting mathematical sciences program, which is called Graphical Dynamical Systems. Today is not a good day to talk about it, but there's huge literature. We've done this for 20 years now, where we build very formal mathematical methods to understand this, you know, and understand this as what is called dynamical systems. For those of you who are not mathematicians, a graphical dynamical system captures this in a somewhat formal setting, which is comfortable for a mathematician to analyze. And we'll at least mention it a little bit as we go along. So the question we were studying when we started building this was this balance between the inflammatory cycle and the regulatory cycle. And we were trying to see when complete tolerance can happen, or hyperinflammation can happen, in using the models we had. Kate and Stephen and Joseph wrote the first paper which actually used ODE-based models. And I think you've already heard Kopassi's talk before. So I think, Kate, correct me, but you used Kopassi to build this model, right?
Yes.
And it's actually got 30 odd equations in it. It was time-consuming in its own right. People really think that building ODE models is quick, but if you want to build ODE models which is useful, it actually often takes a lot of time as well. Need not be that fast. But I think at the end of that, some of the questions were certainly not solved in the manner that we were completely comfortable with. And these are the standard problems when you represent a system using ODEs. One is, if you use a simple differential equation, which is deterministic, then you lose stochasticity. And stochasticity is inherent in the systems, right? You do not have very deterministic movements in these cells. Second is, you assume, infinitely divisible versus discrete entities. Cells are discrete entities, but you really assume this continuous medium in which they're moving around interacting. The third aspect is mass action, which means cells are, interacting with each other essentially uniformly, right? So this is the way you do work, which is captured in biochemistry or chemistry in general, where when you talk about reactions, you can assume this kind of representation. It works out well because you have Avogadro number of molecules to deal with. So the numbers are so large that this uniform mixing assumption is not a bad assumption to work with. We are at a scale which we call mesoscale. We are not so small that we have only hundreds of entities, and we are not so big that we don't have, where we have 10 to the 23 entities as well. Both sides of the coin are reasonably okay to manage. We are somewhere in the middle. We have 10 to the 7, 10 to the 8, 10 to the 9 entities of that kind, where we can't make assumptions which can lead to continuity easily, and we can't go back to very small system which we can analyze by hand. So this is what started the work on NEC. I'll sort of quickly summarize again what NEC was, but it was a modeling framework to study immune responses in the GI. And Stephen, you talked about it in detail, right? So I can skip this, but I'll at least tell you what the feature of this. First is that NEC is not a model itself. It's a modeling environment, which means you as practitioners can actually change some of the criteria of how the cells interact, what cells are represented, and then you can study a different phenomena at hand, which I think is important thing to remember. So in some ways, it is not as general as Kopassi, but it's still general. It's not building on one particular model. Kate studied H. pylori. We've also studied some other diseases, but you can essentially change things there. You can interact with NEC at different levels. Again, you might have heard about this before, but if you're a naive user, in the sense that you do not want to become computer scientist, you really want to focus on the biology, you can use it through a web interface. If you are a little bit more sophisticated in terms of computer training, you can work with configuration files. But at that point, changing the model is not that easy. And then the final setup is where you really can go into the code and change things and build a completely different model itself. And each of them allows you to use NEC in a progressively richer manner. To give you some sense, it's built on a tool called Episymptomics that we developed, and it's an effort that's been going on for 11 years. So it's a fairly complicated piece of code, but modular enough that you can actually still change parts of it with fair bit of ease. As I was telling you, it is based on a mathematical framework which we call co-evolving graphical dynamical systems. For those of you who have not heard what graphical dynamical systems are, they are an abstraction of agent-based modeling, which we'll talk a little bit more again. And the abstraction allows you to study agent-based models in which you have agents or individual entities which interact, and the interaction is usually done on a network, right? Now, if you have a spatial aspect of it, you can still build a network out of it without loss of generality. But in some ways, a much more general framework to represent the system rather than a purely cellular automata-based framework, which you might have heard before through Game of Life, or work that people have done in ecological model setting, where network effects are not picked up. So for instance, where is this interesting and useful where typical CA-like models don't work? When you're studying social networks and you're studying diffusion of social networks. All of you are Facebook users, I'm dead sure by now. So it's an example that requires no explanation. But your friends are not spatially closely located. In fact, people have friends all around the world, right? And now, the best way to capture this interaction is through a concept of an edge in this graph. It's not necessary that anybody who's within some distance by you is the only way you can interact with them. But on the other hand, certain class of systems do admit models of that kind. So I think it's 1922. I'll skip this. Stephen has already talked about what an agent-based models are. There are things, there are states with things, and then they interact. In fact, I've used Stephen's slides, as you might all notice. Maybe it's an exam for you to see how many of you were following this talk and noticed the similarity. I've made no changes. And then you have a set of mathematical rules to change the states of the system. Why am I showing you this, right? This is the part that is important. When they interact, you produce a composite state of the system. The state of the system is, in some ways, the union of the states of individual elements together. So that's a system state at a given time. The problem is, if you have n objects, each of which can take k different individual states, then the potential possibilities for the number of states the system can be is roughly k to the n. And this is a very large number, right? When we're talking about systems, in our case, we're talking about 10 to the 8 cells. So n is 10 to the 8. K is, say, even 3. In fact, Stephen has put down these numbers somewhere here. So even if you have 32 cells with 3 states each, and you want to store the entire possible, you know, state space that the system can go through, it turns out you require 1.5 petabytes of storage, right? It's a very, very large system by any account. And so the way you study this is not by exhaustively reporting every possible move the system makes, but you sample this particular space. A good term for it, people have done some amount of advanced mathematics, is you can view this as a large Markov chain. And you know, you can sample this using what's called a Monte Carlo Markov chain methods and sample parts of the space that are of interest to you in a very particular manner. So the point I'm trying to make is that even with a system with 32 cells, this is a computationally hard problem. So if you do this in a dumb way, you basically are, you know, host. You can keep as big a system you want busy as much of time as you want. So it's not a problem to do that. The question is, what's the meaningful computation that comes out of it? And you can still do that. So in our case, the agents were, of course, bacteria and some of the commensal bacteria and participating cells. Stephen has gone through this. I'll quickly go through it now. Yes.
Can you use typical ideas from ODEs in these agent-based models? Can you like find steady states, or do you have to search for them?
So the difference is the ODEs have a rich mathematics that has already been developed to some extent. Mm-hmm. So by looking at the form of that equation, people have now, at least in some simple cases, really actually simple cases, but they have theorem which say these equations have certain form, then you have a certain form to the state space itself. You have classical, things which you have done, which you take the first derivative, you take the second derivative, you understand what's called the landscape of this. And to some extent, at least for simple structures, this is a problem that we know how to do. In network systems, this theory is in its infancy in many ways. We know this little bit, but this is an open question of how to find a particular state with a characteristic. So if you want to find a particular state in which all the cells are in, say, state 0,
right,
not easy to, you know, figure out how this can be done.
I see, okay.
At least known recipe. So the only known solution in general is to, you know, exhaustively search the space. Now, in specific forms, it is not the case that has to be done. And that's the case in ODE models too. When you have very specific form of linear equations, of equations where the variables have certain relationships, you can do this. Otherwise, it's not doable. So I would say the mathematics is of similar kind. The other mathematics just has had more time to develop. Inherently, this is a mathematics that is going to be more and more complicated in its form. So I want to say something maybe slightly philosophical, but I have said it before and I found an audience which was receptive. So it's not that these agent-based models are always better. Right? There are many, many situations where ODE models actually work out just fine. So I'm not advocating that everybody use agent-based models or interaction-based models all the time. I'm saying that there are problems and situations where this actually makes sense. Secondly, we're also saying that we are not the first ones to have thought of building an agent-based model. People would have, I'm sure, early on thought of building models of this side. In fact, there is evidence that people might have thought. The problem is this. In 1900, if you build out an agent-based model or network-based model for, say, 20-cell system, what do you do after just drawing the picture for 20 cells? The space, as we discussed just now, let's say with 3 states for each cell, is 3 to the 20, right? So there is no way you can do that computation. The reason people build ODE-based models, at least the way I see of it, is that in many cases, you could come with analytically closed-form systems solution. So at least in those cases, the solutions were obtained by essentially paper and pencil exercise, and you could manage, right? So as the systems grow, this particular exercise is not feasible. But we have computations which can help us these days. So this particular form modeling is actually interesting and likely to give good results, and something whose time has come because of advances in computing in our field. So in the interest of the other time, I'll move forward. But what I wanted to tell you was there was some assumption that we made in the first version of NEC that we built out here. So then we started building out a detailed model, and this is work that is actually in progress. I would not claim by any means that this is done, but we started to build a detailed multi-scale model of the gut immune system, and we have 4 different scales that we have been studying: intracellular scale, a scale which is basically you represented using ODE style models or stochastic differential equations when it's needed, a scale that captures the chemokine and cytokine gradients, and here we again use differential equations, but now we're talking about continuous systems. Basically we're talking about fluid like approximation, because these are molecules and the number is numerous enough that this approximation makes sense. We have the classical scale from an NEC standpoint, which is interaction between cells, which is this, and then we have scale where tissue sites are represented. And the numbers here tell you, and the kinds of models that are being used also summarizing in the table here. So the interesting part is that the top layer has been studied using the COPASI model right now. In fact, Audrey probably presented information on it. The cellular scale is what NEC was designed initially to study. And it tells you how we can take, what happened in NEC was that the phenotypic differentiation of a cell was made into a very simple statistical model early on. So when you go from, you know, a cell of certain type, let's say, you know, CD4 T cell to its forms, then that particular process was abstracted out. And as a result, if you wanted to study how this differentiation happens in the real system, our NEC model early on would say nothing about it, because this was really built out as a statistical model. But with this combination now, we have a chance to understand how this differentiation might happen in the first place. There's another thing that can happen in this setting, which I think is a very interesting point, and Joseph was the one who really suggested to us, where you can see lesions forming. And if you think about forming of lesions, it's a very, very nice example of why these detailed agent-based models might be useful and multi-scale models might be useful. Because lesions are an emergent process. You can't say upfront when the model starts where the lesions will form, how big the lesions will be, right? It's a combination of where the initial, so to say, seeds happen for it, how the chemokine, cytokine gradients play out, how the cells get attracted to these places. All these things together will determine where the lesions happen and its relative size and the type. And it's perfectly suitable for a model of the kind that I'm talking about. So we have a very simple version of this where we've been able to build out these lesions. I do not know whether it's biologically significant yet or not, but at least we can show that this phenomena is now reproducible in our model for the first time. but I'll go through this. I want to go at the very end because I have gone up by 2 minutes. There was a set of slides that I have which talk about analyzing large amounts of data that these models produce, which I think, you know, when you look at the slides, it can tell you a little bit more. But I want to end with some questions that people need to remember when we do this. So I have basically said that this is an interesting topic. But I think the hard part here is the classical questions that are available for study in even single scale, and they just get multiplied by a big amount when you study a multi-scale model, which is validation, verification, sensitivity analysis, uncertainty quantification. These problems are present in single scale models, but are even harder, in my opinion, when you study problems here. We have started to play with it, how to set up designs where you can understand parameter sweeps across scales is a non-trivial research question. Some of you might be interested in studying that. And let me conclude by simply saying that I think the multi-scale modeling techniques in system biology are important and natural. They're natural in that we have this natural scales built out in biosystems. And so we can build out these models reasonably well. There have already been success stories in the references that I've talked about. Nevertheless, you should take, some care has to be taken when you build models like this. You need to remember that done wrongly, the computational costs might blow up. Done wrongly, you might not be able to validate the results in a meaningful manner so that a biologist feels comfortable with it. And this is actually another thing that, at least from an experience that me and Stephen have had, I would like to point out. It's not very hard for us to generate a phenomena in silico. You can always massage the numbers to get it. I think working with Joseph and his team allows us to study and build models that a biologist can essentially say is meaningful in the first place. I want to point this out because I think as the field is developing, the synergy between the fields is becoming more and more important, and I have certainly learned a lot by working with biologists on a day-to-day basis, because I realize the way they think about the problem, the way they can try and understand the phenomena at hand itself. Mathematically, sometimes it's fairly easy to do this. It's just the way biologists understand it makes it for an interesting project itself. So I'll stop here, Joseph, if it's okay, and take questions.
What I'd like to do, since we want to stay mostly on time, although we do have some flex time this morning, is that maybe take one question now, but you'll be here as part of the roundtable, right? So there'll be time for a lot of discussion at that point. Does anybody have a burning question they really want to address now?
So, as I understand, these are still work in progress, or are they already in stone that people can look up to as an example or a model?
So there are actually other people's work in system biology that is way further along. For NEC, the multi-scale version is coming up, and I think in another few months we'll have some version of it online. But remember that it will be a very early version. So so far I'm willing to play with it and agree that it will fail, then it will indeed be available. Yes.
Okay, thanks very much.